Good morning, I am Mayor Janelle Kelman, and we are presenting this video to the community to help better inform around the housing element process. Good morning, Beth.
Oh, good morning, Mayor Kelman. I'm Beth Thompson. I'm a principal with DeNovo Planning Group, and our firm is working with the City of Sausalito to manage the housing element update.
Wonderful. So today I'm going to ask you a handful of questions that we're going to share with the community, and this will be available at the next City Council meeting. It'll be posted online and will be available in Currents. So for our first question, can you just explain what is the RENA? What does that stand for and what does it mean?
Absolutely. So the RENA is the Regional Housing Needs Allocation. And I will just share my screen here for a moment so that you can graphically see what the RENA is. So the RENA is assigned by the Association of Bay Area Governments, and it's assigned, let me back up for a moment. The RENA is assigned by the State Department of Housing and Community Development, HCD, to each council of governments throughout the state of California or to individual counties where there is no council of governments. And then the council of governments takes that RENA, the regional housing need allocation, and assigns it to each jurisdiction. What the RENA represents is the number of housing units by income level that each jurisdiction must plan to accommodate during its housing element planning period. So Sausalito's RENA is based on its share of Bay Area growth through 2050. It only addresses an 8-year period, but the overall growth rate is what's used to establish the baseline of the RENA. And then it is adjusted in several ways. It's increased to address access to opportunity and proximity to jobs. So the city has been assigned a total of 724 units. And that includes 315 very low and low income units, which have to be accommodated on larger sites, half an acre to 10 acres, and sites that have a higher density than other sites, or sites that are identified already with a proposed housing project that would be affordable. So typically these sites are harder to accommodate in built out cities like Sausalito. The city also has 114 moderate income units and 295 above moderate income units. And for households or persons that are interested in learning more, the city's website does have a link to the housing element update website, which includes a great table that identifies all of the income levels, affordable housing prices, and affordable rents by income level. So you can understand what this means to individual households in an easier fashion.
Thank you, Beth. And to really simplify this slide and to convey to the community, we are being required by the state to identify sites. And that's the process we're going through now. And those are called opportunity sites. So this is a state mandate placed upon Sausalito, correct?
Correct. Yes. The city does not have the authority or ability to reduce its RENA. It's assigned this number and it must abide by it.
Okay. Why are so many units assigned to Sausalito?
Well, many jurisdictions like Sausalito have actually received a lot of units during this period. And basically, the RENA doesn't take into account any constraints that the city has. So it looks at the city's projected growth through 2050, and then that baseline number is increased. It's increased to represent Sausalito's high resource areas. Sausalito has a better than average access to education, economic, and environmental opportunities, as well as the city's proximity to employment centers. So the base RENA is increased to reflect these factors that affect the city. The RENA does not take into account the city's capacity for growth, so the land that's actually available to accommodate new housing. It doesn't address the infrastructure capacity to serve new growth, whether or not there's capacity in the water and sewer systems, the schools, the roadways. That is not taken into account when the RENA is assigned. It also doesn't address wildfires, emergency evacuation, flooding, landslides, and other constraints that are present in Sausalito. So the RENA is just a big number assigned to the city, and then the city has to figure out how to address it. And in built out jurisdictions like Sausalito, it's extremely difficult.
Thank you. It's very interesting. So I know there have been some questions about, you know, why have we not appealed the numbers? I'll just reiterate this third bullet here. We did appeal our RENA numbers to ABAG. The appeal was denied. You will also find that we did evaluate whether we wanted to join in a lawsuit against the California Department of Housing and Community Development. And after consideration of the issues presented and the confidential advice of the city attorney, we have declined to participate in the potential litigation at this present time. Now, that said, we will continue to monitor and evaluate other opportunities to work with ABAG on our numbers. I also want to then draw our attention to excuse me, what is an opportunity site? And is an opportunity site a commitment to build?
So an opportunity site is a site that's been preliminarily identified in the draft housing element as a site that can be rezoned to accommodate a higher amount of growth than it is currently planned for. So all of the opportunity sites are shown on this figure, as well as existing capacity sites. So the opportunity sites are called housing overlay opportunity sites, and they have cross-hatching on those sites. And the sites with the yellow outline are sites that potentially could accommodate very low and low income units. And sites without the yellow outline with the cross-hatching are sites that would just be upzoned to accommodate greater development. So the housing opportunity sites are sites that are being identified to accommodate the city's RENA because the city's existing sites, the sites with existing capacity for additional development, are not adequate to accommodate 724 units in the city. So the city has to identify additional places where growth can be increased. So what does that mean when you have an opportunity site? Does it have to be used to develop new housing? Will new housing be developed on it during the planning period? No. So the opportunity sites are sites that the city has identified. And once the housing element is adopted, the sites will then be rezoned. And so there's a larger amount of opportunity sites in the housing element than the city needs to accommodate the RENA to give the city some flexibility in identifying which sites will actually be included in the final housing element and rezoned in the future. Once the sites are rezoned, they don't have to be developed, but if the city does receive a development proposal, it does have to allow a maximum amount of growth identified for those opportunity sites. So their sites would be rezoned for typically 49 to 70 units per acre. And so you would have to accommodate development that's consistent with the city's zoning, that meets the requirements of the city's design guidelines, development standards, and all of the city's requirements. Some projects can apply for a ministerial process, which means that the city doesn't have the discretion to deny those projects. So projects that are eligible would go through a streamlined review process, and then projects that don't qualify for that streamlined review process would go through the city's typical design review and approval process that would go to Planning Commission and go out for public review.
And Beth, moving on from the opportunity sites, what are density bonuses and how do they affect development potential?
Density bonuses are a tool used by the state to reward developers who will provide affordable housing. So when a developer comes in and offers to provide very low and low income units and other qualified units, they're eligible to receive a density bonus. And density bonuses are granted on a sliding scale based on the percentage of very low and low and other qualified units in a development. So typical our density bonuses go up to 80%. So that means the total amount of growth on a site can be increased by up to 80%, and that the city has to allow that growth for projects that are qualified. The housing element, however, isn't allowed to count the density bonus units. So you'll note that when you're going through the housing element, we're not applying the maximum number of units that could be developed on a density bonus against the RENA. The state requires that the city actually reduce the planned growth when making realistic capacity assumptions for sites. So the realistic capacity assumptions are much lower than what could actually be built on a site. Now, in order to receive a density bonus, the project has to provide affordable units. And not every site can be developed with a density bonus because there's typically not enough subsidy offered by the state to accommodate a density bonus at every site. So you'll probably see density bonuses on some of the sites, but not all of the sites during the planning period.
And does a density bonus then mean that a site could be larger in terms of number of units than originally anticipated for your third bullet here?
Correct.
Let's move on to SB 9. What is Senate Bill 9 and how does that impact our housing numbers?
Senate Bill 9 was passed to allow intensification of single family neighborhoods. So it is applied to areas with single family zoning and it allows an existing single family lot to be developed with up to four units. And so What happens is you can either have a proposal for two units on a single family lot, or a property owner can come in and request a lot split and then have up to two units on each lot. Those could be duplexes or single family units. We do get some credit for SB 9 units in the housing element. We can't assume that every lot in the city will be developed with an SB 9 unit in order to accommodate the full RENA, but we can make some reasonable assumptions. So we have assumed that some of the underutilized lots with existing development in the city, would be developed with additional units under SB 9, as well as vacant lots with single family zoning, that those would be developed under SB 9. And that gives the city some additional units to count toward the RENA. However, the SB 9 units don't provide a significant source of the very low and low income units. So there still is a pretty large gap even after applying the SB 9 units for that very low and low number.
So Beth, Cecily is largely built out. And in your first slide, you explain that the RENA numbers don't take into account on the ground conditions. Let's talk about infrastructure. Who pays for critical infrastructure updates related to this?
So those will come through a variety of mechanisms. Let me think for a moment of the easiest way to characterize this. So you have multiple infrastructure providers serving the city. The city of Sausalito provides roads, you provide sewer infrastructure, Marin Water provides water, and then the Southern Marin Sanitary District also provides wastewater treatment. So all of these service providers will have to update their master plans. Not only has Sausalito received a large RENA, jurisdictions throughout Marin County have received much higher numbers than were planned for. So in order to accommodate this growth, the infrastructure providers will need to update their master plans and figure out how and where to improve infrastructure. Now, when projects come forward, they will pay a fair share fee, typically a development impact fee, that goes toward their fair share of costs for those increases, the increased capacity and increased infrastructure being developed to accommodate growth. Some projects may also provide construction of some improvements, either on-site or off-site. However, typically this doesn't address the full amount of infrastructure needed to accommodate all growth. So there will still be a portion of those costs that are going to have to be accommodated by the infrastructure providers themselves.
And what happens if the infrastructure can't be expanded to accommodate the new growth?
Then the state will likely comment on the city's housing element, because in the housing element, we discuss the capacity of service providers. And then in the draft EIR, we'll also discuss the capacity of service providers. And the city will be required to include programs in the housing element to expand infrastructure capacity. Where it's outside of the city's control, you'll work with those other infrastructure providers. Where it's within the city's control, the city would work, would enact those changes locally. The state will be monitoring every jurisdiction's implementation of the housing element, including progress towards accommodating infrastructure. However, there's not a specific approach that the state takes where there is not adequate infrastructure. So it may be that you plan throughout the housing period and you don't demonstrate adequate infrastructure, and then that just becomes an ongoing issue that you have to address in the seventh cycle.
Okay, really important, obviously, to be aware of that. Okay, so I want to be responsive now to numerous emails we've received about the City Hall site. We've been receiving emails where folks are concerned that they saw a design for development at City Hall and are asking when and why did the city approve the development? Can you please respond to that?
Sure. So there are a couple of things going on with the City Hall site. Back in spring, the city had a golden shovel competition. So the University of California at Berkeley, as well as Stanford University, participated in a competition to develop the best plans for the City Hall site and the larger Caledonia Street area. And so these plans are not actual plans for development. They look much like an actual plan for development. They're very polished, but they're actually class projects that were developed by students at those universities. So the large scale projects that people may see planned for the City Hall sites are just conceptual development ideas and visionary plans for that area. Now, the housing element does identify City Hall as a potential opportunity site. However, the city hasn't yet approved the housing element, so there is not a specific number of units that have been adopted for City Hall. So as the city goes through this planning process, the Planning Commission and the City Council will both have the opportunity to weigh in on whether or not the City Hall site should be included and what the appropriate number of units is to assign to City Hall.
So to put it very simply, the city has not approved any project at City Hall. City Hall will be listed as an opportunity site, but no project has been approved or reviewed as part of the housing element, correct?
Absolutely, that is correct.
Okay. Two more questions here. How will development proposals for the opportunity sites be handled?
And let me just quickly, I had a previous slide on that, but those will just be handled as development proposals are handled in the city. So the housing element does not include any development proposals or entitlements for specific development projects. So in order to have a project approved by the city, the developer will come and submit an application to the city. The city will then process that application either with a streamlined ministerial review if the project's eligible for expedited and ministerial or non-discretionary review, or the city will process it in its typical fashion and it will go to Planning Commission and go through the design review process. So all of the projects will be a submitted application. They'll be available for public comment and they'll just go through that process. So there aren't any projects that will be slipped in with the housing element and approved in advance. However, for the sites that are included in the housing element, the city will have to entertain development proposals and can't just outright deny projects on those parts, you know, on those parcels. So there is definitely the capacity for additional development and approval of additional development projects once the housing element's adopted.
Okay. Again, so then to clarify, we will see proposals for all projects that want to be placed on an opportunity site, and there will be public hearings and feedback. The only exception to that would be SB9, which is a ministerial review, but that is not part of the opportunity sites listed in the housing element, correct?
Correct, SB9. And then there are also some other streamlined approvals, SB 330, SB 35, that also provide for a similar streamlined process where those projects wouldn't go through the public hearing process. But those projects, the city can still announce that those projects have been applied for and let the community know that the projects are out there and that they're being reviewed for consistency with the city standards.
But projects proposed on opportunity sites will be subject to public review and hearings.
Except for the ones that are for streamlined review. So yes, in general, most of the projects on the opportunity sites would go through the public review and hearing process. I wouldn't anticipate that all projects coming through would be eligible for the streamlined process.
Okay. Something for us to keep an eye on, though, so that we understand which ones may be subject to the streamlined process.
Correct.
Okay. So last question is about community engagement. I know we have a robust community engagement program. Unfortunately, many folks still aren't aware of the process. How can we respond to folks who ask about receiving notice about the housing element update?
There are a lot of ways to become involved. So just to let people know, a mailer was sent to every household in the city. Every resident in the city should have received a mailer, as well as every property owner in the city. So at the start of the process, the city sent out a mailer to let everyone know about the housing element update, let them know how to become involved, and give them some opportunities to take some surveys and provide feedback. The city continues to provide updates in the Currents newsletter, as well as direct emails to people who've registered and identified interest in the housing element update process. So anyone who wants to be involved and wants to be notified should go to the to the registration page, and that's available via the housing element update website. And I've also included the direct email or the direct URL for it, https://www.surveymonkey.com/r/Sausalito HE stakeholder. So if you visit that, you can register as a stakeholder and you will be placed on the mailing list. You'll receive emails when new documents are available, when meetings are being held. So as progress continues with the housing element update, you'll be apprised of the upcoming events and activities.
Thank you very much, Beth. Talk to you soon.
Thank you. Have a great morning.